Welcome to worship at Millage Avenue Baptist Church. We are delighted that you have chosen to spend this hour with us virtually as we worship God together. This morning we will hear and learn from Jesus about his words to take up the cross and follow him. May that be our prayer and wish this week. Let us go to God now in prayer. Almighty God, thank you for this moment where we can gather to worship you. Accept our offering of prayer, of singing, of listening, and help us to hear your words and your message for us today. May we bring glory and honor to you, and may we show your love and care for others as we go back into the world. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Tells his disciples how he will die and is rebuked by Peter. A reading from Matthew chapter 16, verses 21 through 28. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, God, "Forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. For you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return to their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." This is the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong.
Good morning. And before our prayer this morning, I wanted to take a quick second and give you a quick update from the Finance Committee. I also wanted to say we'll have more detail for everyone today during the church conference by way of the Zoom platform. I think you'll like that if you've never used it before. It really works and allows us to come all together live. But God has certainly provided provision for Millage Avenue during this time of uncertainty caused by the pandemic. I'm thankful that God has given us leadership and faithful servants from both staff and lay leadership. You know, how could we have been able to continue to have our services without Jenny and Tom and Nathan? Their leadership has been outstanding. And I'm so thankful for Carol Selig and Dan Aiken and William Jones and John Culpepper and countless others who have just, you know, have just stepped up to help us find God's way for our church. You know, I also want to tell you that God has cared for us financially by the way of your tithes and offerings, our giving. Our giving is exceeding our expenses. So in addition, the payroll protection program from our government has been very helpful. And it allowed us to build a reserve or, you know, maybe even an operating, a bit of operating capital going into our new fiscal year. Thank you, and please continue your support of our church. Would you please join me in prayer? Father God, thank you for the daily provision you are providing Millage Avenue Baptist Church. You have blessed us with faithful stewards who shepherd this church through a difficult, uncharted time, a time when your church needs them. Father, give them strength and let them feel your guiding hand in all that they do. Thank you for giving us a solid foundation on which to start a new financial year. We ask for your continued guidance. Father God, we also ask for you to guide us as we seek your will for Millage Avenue going forward. Father, guide our search for both an interim and for permanent minister. lead us every step of the way and mold our vision so that it is in fact your vision for Millage Avenue here in Athens, Georgia. And Father, it is in Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Sometimes I try to imagine what the disciples must have thought as they wandered along with Jesus. Have you ever done that? Especially when I read some of the truly outlandish, absurd statements that Jesus made or the crazy stories he told. In seminary, I had Dr. James Blevins for several classes. Dr. Blevins was one of those professors that every student loved. He would come to class some days dressed in character. Sometimes he would prep the class in advance and saying, "We're having a special visitor tomorrow, be on time." And so when we came to class the following day, we were excited to see who was going to be there to meet us. He came as controversial preachers throughout history. He came as characters in Bible stories. But my favorite times are when he would come as one of the writers of the books of the Bible. He would teach class from that author's perspective. He would tell the stories and parables from that writing, highlighting phrasing, story placement, and word choice. When he taught in that way, the stories of the Bible took on new meaning for me. My imagination had more fuel to think about the scenes. One such story Dr. Blevins acted out is today's passage from Matthew. But Matthew isn't the only one who records Jesus shocking the disciples with this statement. This incident is in all four Gospels and appears twice in two of them. As Dr. Blevins told the story, he focused on one of the words in the story, acting out the scene for the class, illustrating the story with a ruler. But I'm getting ahead of myself. This scene occurs just after Peter declares that Jesus is the Messiah. All of the other disciples are pumped. Jesus is happy. Peter's confidence is booming. Peter, always outspoken, always quick to raise his hand to interrupt or to give a wrong answer or a weird suggestion, actually got the right answer this time. Jesus praises his faith and his deep attention to the Spirit. But then Jesus turns to his followers and becomes somber. He defines for them what being the Messiah will mean for him. He tells them that he must die and be raised from the dead 3 days later. What a buzzkill. What a way to kill the mood, right? Apparently, all Peter heard was Jesus say he was going to die and do so willingly. Well, Peter couldn't stand it, and he grabbed Jesus and pulled him off to the side to speak to him in private. He rebuked Jesus for talking about his death. The Greek word that's translated rebuke is epitimao. It literally means to rap on the knuckles. You know, like teachers used to do with rulers in old school classrooms. When a student was acting out or being lazy, the teacher would grab a trusty ruler, have the student hold out his or her hand, and pop them across the knuckles. Epitimao. Ouch! Then Jesus, in turn, rapped Peter on the knuckles in rebuke and says something even more unexpected. He lashes out at Peter, calling him Satan, which translated is the accuser or the tempter. And Jesus says to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me." Jesus again used the play on words of rock like we talked about last week. Just a few seconds ago in the story, Jesus called Peter a chip off the old block and said, "Upon this rock I will build my kingdom." But now he calls Peter a stumbling block and tells him he's not thinking about spiritual things, but human things. Then Jesus says the most startling part of this exchange. He tells his followers that if they are going to continue to follow him, they must be willing to take up their cross. Take up their cross? Do you know what that means? Jesus is asking them to take up their cross, and that means to willingly walk to their own crucifixion. No one does that. There would be no reason to do it. It would mean like going to an execution with others who wanted to watch and then jumping in line behind the convicted and the condemned saying, "Well, this should be fun." It would be the equivalent of an innocent man who's never been accused of any crime going up to Georgia State Penitentiary, knocking on the gate and asking to be added to death row. In fact, to be placed at the front of the line. Even then, even more confusing, Jesus makes the nonsensical, paradoxical statement that those who want to save their lives will lose them. And those who want to lose their life for Jesus' sake will actually find life. What? What do you think those hearing Jesus say this thought? How did they respond? How would you have responded? Have you ever been in a situation where you had no idea what was going on? When you wondered if you had made a mistake about joining in or following along? When you felt you were in over your head? When you second-guessed your choices or your involvement? I've had some students in the past who got involved with Bible studies on campus. After a few weeks of attending, they were presented the opportunity to join the group. It sounded like a great idea, and to officially become a member, this student would have to meet with one of the adult leaders. That sounded reasonable. The meeting with the adult leader went well until at the end of the meeting, the leader added a caveat, an additional requirement that sounded rather odd. I've heard all sorts through the years of random groups on campus like this. "You'll have to ask me before you hang out with somebody of the opposite sex," they were told. Or, "You will need to give us access to your bank account so that we can withdraw your tithe when we need funds." Or, we ask for the next 3 months that you don't have any contact with your parents so that we can make sure you're under our authority." In each of those cases, the students either said no, or they would have to think about it and get back later, or they came to us immediately for advice on what to do. This statement from Jesus should be even more shocking to us than those I just mentioned, but we've heard this statement and this story so many times before that I fear we're not hit by the absurdity of it like the disciples were. Some version of this statement appears in at least once in all four Gospels. And Jesus says very similar things in other places, including in Revelation. Each of the authors deemed that this was so important that it had to be included in their story of Jesus' life and ministry. It gives us a glimpse so that we can understand where Jesus was going and what he was saying to his followers. It leads us to see a level of commitment that other stories may not give us. It's interesting to hear how each of the gospel writers preserves this lesson. In Mark 35:37, we see it the first time. "Whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul?" And then in Luke, this idea is included two different times. In Luke 9:24, Jesus had grown tired of the scores of groupies that were following him along to see what he'd do next. So he turned to the multitudes and makes this crazy statement out of the blue. "If you want to follow me, you must take up your cross, for whoever would save his life would lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits his soul?" The story says that many turned away at that and stopped following Jesus. Jesus repeated the statement again in 17:33. "Whoever seeks to preserve his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life will keep it." And then Matthew has Jesus making the statement twice as well. First in Matthew 10:39, "Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." And in our verses from today's passage, Matthew 16:25, Jesus says again, "For whoever would lose his life, whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." And then finally in John 12:25, Jesus says, "Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in the world will keep it for eternal life." Why does Jesus make such shocking statements? Was he serious? Was he really expecting his followers to walk up to the Roman centurions and volunteer to be crucified? Or was he speaking metaphorically? Was Jesus advocating risky behavior just to get noticed? Before you get any crazy ideas, Jesus is not talking about going out and engaging in life-risking behavior. So in my role as senior adult pastor, I need to issue a warning. Senior adults, stay off your grandkids' skateboards, pogo sticks, and mountain bikes and trampolines. Norris, I'm talking to you particularly. So what's going on here? For all of the gospel writers to include this, it must have meant something that it was something Jesus talked about a good bit. It must have been one of his key teachings. It must have been the disciples' answer when asked, "What's one thing Jesus always says?" They must have come away believing that this was one of Jesus' key teachings, a mantra, if you will. It was probably one of those statements that when Jesus started the first line, they could all repeat the rest of it with him, like your children do with you and my children do with me, or we do with our parents or teachers. But we can also surmise something else here. Thomas Long suggests that in Jesus' reaction to Peter, we can see his humanity and find kinship with him. Likewise, Ben Witherington suggests that Jesus' reaction to Peter shows that Jesus, too, was tempted with the lure of safety, normalcy, and the pursuit of personal gratification, in that he was no different than we are. Just like we are tempted, Jesus was tempted. Nikos Kazantzakis wrote a book called The Last Temptation of Christ. He explores this very idea. How would things have been different if Jesus had lived seeking contentment and personal satisfaction instead of the route that he took? It's a wonderful book, and it explores what Jesus might have been wrestling with on his way to Calvary. It explores the what ifs that probably we have all thought through in our own lives, even if we never really would choose a different way. What if I chose this over that? What if I left the job with all of the drama that I'm in the middle of and just walked out and never looked back? How would things be different? What would my life look like? What if I took that offer? It would mean that I might have to bend the rules a bit, but sure would pay me a lot more money. I wonder what my life would be like. What if I just walk away from all the commitments I've made and opt for something new? What if I just throw everything out of the window and start over? What could that be like for me? We've all imagined such situations. The ending of the book is as you imagine. Jesus continues on the path to the cross, choosing to die as he had lived for the sake of others, guided by his relationship with God. Jesus asked his disciples to be aware of what this journey would cost them. He asked them to count the cost before continuing on mission with him. Jesus wanted those closest to him to know that if they continued on this path, they might well end up dying for it. Jesus wanted to shock them into reality, to make sure they understood what they were getting into. Jesus didn't want them just going along only to realize when it was too late that they didn't want to be a part of this. Jesus wanted wide awake, willing followers who knew where they were headed and knew how this might end. But I think there's more to it than just understanding where following him could lead. Jesus also taught his disciples that the only way to find lasting meaning and fulfillment in life is to intentionally make the daily choice to give our lives away. Jesus called it dying to self, or taking up the cross. Richard Rohr talks about this too. He talks about the dichotomy between the true self and the false self. The false self is self-centered, myopic, ego-driven. The true self, on the other hand, is free. When we hide behind a false self, a self intent on feeding our own ego, we might be happy for a bit, but the ego is never satisfied. Like Audrey, the alien plant in the musical Little Shop of Horrors, the ego, the false self, demands more and more until it takes over everything. If we ever realize our mistake, it's often too late. Panic ensues, and like the main character of the play, we believe the only solution is to burn everything down, to dramatically kill the plant, kill our ego, so we can start anew. Rohr suggests that we must let go of this false self to embrace the true self by living for others, not living with one eye constantly tied to the mirror, or maybe more appropriately, to the likes we get on Instagram, Facebook, and Snapchat, or whatever the newest ego-boosting social media app is out there. How does this apply to us? How does this apply to us as a congregation? How does this apply to our families? How does this apply to us as individuals? before we get too radical here, I want to make sure we're clear. Jesus is not asking us to skip out on our responsibilities to care for our families and for ourselves. Of course, we need to make sure that those in our care are cared for. Of course, we need to make wise financial decisions. Of course, we need to make wise career choices. But in all of these matters, we should be checking our motivations. Contrary to what Gordon Gekko says in the movie Wall Street, greed is not good for followers of Jesus. In fact, that's the opposite of Jesus' intention here. What is the practical takeaway for us? Are there decisions that we have made more for ourselves, for our comfort, for our own glory than for the sake of others? Are there policies or practices that we've undertaken or that we've avoided as a congregation that affect others that are not in our congregation? Are we myopic? 1 year I was asked to serve on the Missions Partnership Task Force of the Georgia Baptist Convention. Part of my work at the GBC was helping to establish mission assignments around the globe where collegians could travel and do projects that are particularly suited to their skill set and their available time. The task force gathered to discuss the possibility of establishing a partnership between the convention and a small African country. A few of the members in the task force had traveled to this country on a site visit, and they were here to present their report this day. After they presented, there was a lot of conversation centered around the great needs of that country and the possible expectations the folks who live there might have on those of us coming to help. Some in the group said that pastors and church leaders in that country would expect us to help their children come to the U.S. and go to college. I got excited. Others said that they would expect us to help some of their members perhaps get U.S. citizenship and come live with other family members already here. I got excited. Others said that this particular country had been in a partnership with another state as well, and in those relationships, they wanted the partnership to go both ways. People from that African country wanted to bring mission teams to the United States, just as we would send teams there. As each person in the group talked, I got more and more excited. It seemed like this was the perfect spot for us to spend 3 or 4 years giving, but also learning. This would be truly a partnership where there was give and take, where students would learn that we're called to do more than just go on an occasional vacation mission trip or vacation with a purpose, but we're called to invest our lives in partnership with others. I was shocked when it came time for a vote, and almost all in the room voted against moving forward. The final statement was that the cost would be too great for our churches and our people. I left that meeting more than discouraged. I was devastated. I came away understanding that for so many people to do missions, it's for themselves, not truly to help others. So many people have taken these scriptures to heart, however. Most of the folks we don't hear about, they're unsung heroes. We've never heard of them because those who have died to self, who have taken up their cross, do not seek personal glory. I imagine you have folks coming to mind that you know of that have done amazing sacrificial things for the sake of others, often at great personal cost. Following Jesus often demands that we change and that we give up things to meet needs of those around us. I think about one of my former students, Becca Stanley. Becca graduated from UGA and married and moved to the North Atlanta suburbs and began her career as a photographer and writer. And they began to grow their family. Her husband, Adam, a school teacher in inner city Atlanta, would spend his summers at a camp that he had gotten involved with for those inner city kids. All year long, Becca and Adam would work together to plan for the next summer's camps. They would spend many hours in downtown Atlanta meeting families and parents and playing with children and helping children and teens and mentoring them in some of the roughest parts of the city. The summer camp became the highlight of the year for the whole family because they would spend their summer with these inner city kids at this camp in the mountains. After a few years, Becca asked Adam, "Why do we live here? Our hearts are in the city. Let's move." And so they did. They pulled up their roots in this middle-class suburban neighborhood and moved to one of the toughest parts of Atlanta. They bought a home and remodeled it. They began to meet neighbors. They put up a basketball goal. They started a football program in the parks in downtown Atlanta. Their home became the place where all the teens in the neighborhood wanted to hang out and watch the big screen. Becca befriended some of the moms around there, and they lived life together as full members of the community. They had babies together and raised their children together. Each year, Becca and her family would take vacations to the beach and mountains, but they wouldn't go alone. They would bring neighborhood kids with them. They would show them the beach. They would take them to the mountains, usually for the first time. In the past few years, Becca and Adam have had a new vision. They want to build a community center to expand their work, so they bought an old building on a corner lot near their home. They've recently torn down the building and begin the prospects of building this new community center. They've been through all the hoops that they had to jump through of new building permits and rezoning rules. Their dream is becoming a reality. They did this while raising their own children with the craziness of being young, working parents. Their son was born with a heart defect, and it's required numerous surgeries. There have been other personal costs to them moving their whole lives and their family, but they've not complained. In fact, moving to the inner city has caused them to say they found their lives, not lost them. In the news these days, we read about folks making extreme sacrifices to follow their convictions inspired by their faith. The media and some politicians have tried to politicize these efforts, but I love reading the faith journey these folks are on. Individuals in churches on the U.S.-Mexico border have tried to care for those who've come seeking refuge. They leave water and food in the desert so that these desperate people will be able to survive in their journey along the way. Some congregations have offered sanctuary to those seeking or awaiting immigration hearings. Some of these Good Samaritans have even been arrested for trying to help. There are folks who have taken to the streets recently because of racial unrest, like in the civil rights era of the 1960s. Members of the clergy and those sitting in the pews of congregations have been moved to join people of color as they protest. These justice warriors, as they're calling themselves, join in for several reasons. Some join to stand in solidarity and faith with those who are protesting. Others join to stand between those protesting and those who are seeking to incite violence with the protesters. They put themselves in harm's way for the sake of others. I've heard both declare that their faith demands that they act. There are so many others. People in congregations around our nation feel compelled to act, often with selfless abandon. There are those in our own community doing great work that often carries great personal expense, but they don't complain. In giving themselves away, they have found life. When I was a campus minister, I'd often have students come to talk about how miserable, anxious, or worried they were, just in general. As we talked it over a few meetings, it became obvious that they'd become overly concerned with personal success and happiness. They saw their friends succeeding when they were only spending time in class. They watched Instagram and other social media and compared their lives to the images they saw there. They worried about parental expectations and living up to the accolades and awards they had received in high school. My suggestion to each one was simple. Each day, find a way to serve somebody else. It can be a little thing. Do something each day that has no personal benefit. In fact, look for opportunities that force you to stray from your own comfort to help someone who will never know who did it. Then each time I met with the students, I would hear their successes and taking their eyes off of themselves. Each time I would encourage them to do a little more extreme giving to others, eventually asking them to forego a beach trip over spring break and go on a mission trip, or to give up their summer and go do a summer missions experience instead of taking a summer job to earn money. I would ask them to consider volunteering weekly on a strict schedule that would force them to give up some valuable time and energy in the juggle of classes. It didn't take long before each one of these students had minds that were changed. They were no longer miserable. In fact, by taking their eyes off of themselves, they gained a level of happiness and joy that they could not have foreseen. Jesus was right, you know. When we take our eyes off of ourselves and begin to focus on others, we find life. When we stop trying to live for ourselves and begin to live for Jesus and for the sake of others, we discover pure joy. When we give up an attitude of selfishness and adopt an attitude of service, we discover that we can begin to see things from Jesus' upside-down perspective. And suddenly, the cross that Jesus asks us to take up does not seem like a negative anymore. Jesus only calls us to die to our false self so that we can live into our true self, the self that we were actually created to be. For it is only when we take our eyes off of ourselves that we can allow Jesus to incarnationally live and love through us. Let's pray. Jesus, we chuckle sometimes at your difficult statements and we roll your eyes at your clueless disciples until we suddenly see ourselves in their place. And really, we realize that we too are clueless and that we too need to be shocked back into reality. Thank you for these difficult words. And God, help us each day to wrestle with dying to self. Help us to come to see that it is only in giving our lives away that we find it. And God, as we do, help us to realize you are with us every step along the way. And as we do, help us to see the joy that we are creating in our own lives and in the lives of those around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Send forth thy God's blessing, our true faith confessing, the people of God from his dwelling take leave. The service is ended, all now be extended, the fruits of our worship in all who believe. The seed of the teaching, receptive souls reaching, shall blossom in action for God and for all. God's grace did invite us, and love shall unite us to work for God's kingdom and answer the call.